Good morning. Welcome to King Moravian. It's good to see you here today. Thank you for those who are here worshiping on our front lawn. We're a little bit more spread out, maybe not quite as many as we've had before. Who knows, maybe a cloudy day has kept some people away, but not you. Thank you so much for being here. Also, we appreciate those who are watching our service today. If you are watching, our bulletin and our liturgy that we're using for our service are on our website, kingmoravianchurch.org. So welcome. Let me call your attention to some of our announcements. They are in your bulletin. Next Sunday is a very special Sunday for us. Not only is it Pentecost, we remember the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the disciples, but it's also our graduate Sunday. And we're looking forward to many of our graduates being here, the opportunity to honor them for their accomplishment. We are going to be continuing with our outdoor services. I know that the state, the nation has kind of lessened any kind of mandate on masks inside or outside. But I think for now, and unless you hear otherwise, we're just going to continue to go along with what our task force has said. We'll continue our outdoor services through this month, and then beginning Sunday, June 6th, we'll be indoors for our worship service. We are going to be offering a fellowship event for anyone who plays golf or who would want to play golf. This Tuesday, we are going to get a group that's going to meet together around 5:30 at Pilot Knob Golf Course. They have worked out some rates for us. So if you're interested in that, please come and join us. We're hoping that can just be a good time for some folks to get together. Also, next Sunday, I want to let our college students know we are going to do a college cookout. We'll be in touch with them about that, but that will be over at our home. Also, please note in regard to our flower calendar, we certainly are very thankful for the flowers that are presented today from Dunn and Desty McEwan in honor of Drake. And I believe, Drake, I know you're way back there, but is this for a birthday that you have? Yes, our director of music, Drake Flynt, is have a birthday. So when you see him after the service, if you get to, please tell him happy birthday. We certainly appreciate all he does here for our church family. Also, please note that Vacation Bible School is going to be coming up. We'd love to have children register for that, if you will. And also, as we get inside, we're hoping to have an audio-visual team to work on that as we continue to want to provide our services online. Let us now prepare our hearts for worship as we have our prelude by Jennifer and then our call to worship by our choir today, Annette Covington, Kim Grabs, Ann Lawrence, and Desty McEwan. Let us worship the Lord. Thank you, Jennifer, and thank you, choir. Friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice, let us be glad in it, and let us worship the Lord. Part of our service today will have an emphasis on the ascension of Jesus. It is a time 40 days after Jesus rose from the dead that he ascended into heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God the Father. That will be part of our emphasis today. And one of our opening hymn is a hymn on the ascension. Hail the day that sees him rise. Let us stand as we sing our opening hymn together. Let us remain standing. I think we might have had just a little bit of a mix-up in our opening hymn. We thank our choir for singing what they did. I'd like for us just to say the words together, because it is such an important part of what we do today. Let's join together in the verses. Hail the day that sees him rise, alleluia. To his throne above the skies, alleluia. Christ the Lamb for sinners given, alleluia. Reascends his native heaven, alleluia. There for him high triumphant waits, hallelujah. Lift your heads, eternal gates, hallelujah. He has conquered death and sin, hallelujah. Take the King of glory in, hallelujah. Highest heaven its Lord receives, hallelujah. Yet he loves the earth he leaves, hallelujah. Though returning to his throne, hallelujah, still he calls the world his own, hallelujah. See, he lifts his hands above, hallelujah. See, he shows the Prince of Love, hallelujah. Hark, his gracious lips bestow, hallelujah. Blessings on his church below, hallelujah. And let us remain standing as we join together in our liturgy for Ascension. It is the insert in your bulletin. And let us pray our liturgy together. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, and you be lifted up, you everlasting doors. And the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Yes, lift them up, you everlasting doors. And the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. The Lord has prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. The Father of glory has raised Christ from the dead and made him to sit at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things in subjection under his feet and made him head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all.
To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever.
Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. I ascend to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God."
If we are raised with Christ, let us seek those things which are above, where Christ sits at the right hand of God.
O most merciful Savior, as you were raised from the dead,
may we also walk in newness of life.
As thou didst ascend into heaven,
may we set our minds on things above.
As you sit on the throne,
may we be confident of final triumph.
As you make intercession for us,
may we rejoice in forgiveness and peace.
As angels honor you in heaven,
may every tongue on earth confess thy name.
And when we see you face to face,
may we share thy glory.
Seeing that we have a great high priest who has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect was tempted as we are, yet without sin.
We will with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time of need.
Thus says the Lord, "I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is athirst, I will give of the water of life freely. He that overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son."
Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Amen."
Now let us stand for the closing hymn of our liturgy.
Thank you.
We come to our time of prayer as a church family. I do have several concerns I would like to share with you today. I'd like us to remember this morning, Gina Handy, this past week. Gina went to the hospital. She found out that she had a broken femur, and so she's been in a lot of pain for a while now, but maybe this will take care of it. She had hip replacement surgery. She should be leaving the Clemens Medical Center sometime today, so keep her in your prayers. We pray for those who have had recent knee replacement surgery. They are John Matthews and Pat McGalliard. Pat is doing very well. John has had a little bit of reaction to some of his medication, so please keep him in your prayers. Keep both of them. Let's continue to pray for Roger Cook. Roger has not been doing well these past weeks, so I know he appreciates our prayers. He is still able to get out a little bit. We certainly thank him for still making it to the office on Fridays to be able to fold our bulletins that we have. And so, Roger, please know that you're in our prayers. I'd like us to remember Budge Gage and his family upon the passing of his daughter-in-law, Carol Gage, this week. Budge, you and your family are certainly in our prayers. Let's also remember the family and friends of Tom Cooper. Tom is one of our former members, the gentleman that lived right across from our church office. He died unexpectedly, so let's certainly keep his family in your prayers. I also want us to remember the family of Emily Bahia. This is a request from Myra Wright. She is friends of their family. Emily Bahia is a 10-year-old girl who passed away this past week due to an allergic reaction. So that's certainly a very sad thing for that family and their friends. So please keep them in your prayers. Kathy Anderson asked that we pray for her father, Joseph Mackay, who is going to be having hip replacement surgery this week. Eleanor Ashburn, one of our preschool students who has been in the hospital this week for most of the week at Brenner Children's Hospital with a growth issue. She had a procedure done and that went very well, and so she is home now, so we're very thankful for that. Please keep her in your prayers. Also, one who we have helped with Mission Blitz, a lady named Brenda Steele. She found out that she has liver cancer, and so she asked for prayers, and so let's lift up Brenda Steele in prayer as well. Good news from Anita Jones. She tells me that Avery Parnell, who had surgery in Texas a couple weeks ago, is doing well, so we're very glad to hear that. Anita, will keep him in our prayers. Also, we pray for our schools, especially as they're winding down the year. We certainly pray for teachers, administrators, and students. Pray it can be a good end of the year, and hopefully for many, a well-rested summer coming up. We pray for our healthcare workers. We pray for our nation as we hopefully are coming out of this pandemic, but there's still a ways to go, a little bit. So also, please continue to keep those in your prayers that are on our prayer list. If there's anything to report on them, any updates, just please let me know. If there's any we need to add to it, let us know that as well. We come to a time of prayer. I would like to lift a prayer, but also give you the opportunity in the prayer to bring before God any concerns that are upon your hearts, concern of others, and maybe some of your own personal needs. Let us pray. Oh, Lord God, thank you so much for just a wonderful morning to come. Thank you so much for those that are gathered here. Thank you, Lord, for those that are watching. And thank you for your presence that is with us here. And you're also with those who are watching us now. We also thank you, Lord, that your presence is with those that we are praying for right now. We pray, Lord, for those who have been in the hospital, who are there, who will be going. We lift a special prayer, Lord, for those who are lost loved ones. And we ask, Lord, that your comfort and your strength just continue to be with them. We pray, Lord, for those who maybe are dealing with some uncertainties, whether it be through disease or illness or just life situations. Lord, just watch over and care for each and every person that we pray for. May we truly see your hand at work in their lives. And Lord, we take the time now not only to lift before you those that are mentioned, but also those that are upon our hearts. And Lord, just hear our prayers that we lift for you. Prayers for others, prayers for ourselves. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers and acting upon those that we pray for. For it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We continue our service as we turn to God's Word. Two passages, one from the Gospel of John, one from the book of Acts. Both of these are passages that deal with Jesus' ascensions. Ken Lida, and we certainly do thank Ken. I thank him personally, and I hope you'll thank him also. When we've done these outdoor services, he is always, I won't really know, but I think he's always the first person here getting things set up. and he does a wonderful job with that, working with our ushers. He rang our bell today. I asked him if he'd like to preach. He just said he wasn't prepared, but if he was, I imagine he would have. But today he is also our lay reader. So Ken, we thank you.
Good morning. From John 16, verses 25 through 28, Jesus said, "Though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but will tell you plainly about my Father. In that day, you will ask in my name. I'm not saying that I will ask the Father on your behalf. No, the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father." And from Acts 1, verses 1 through 11. "In my former book," now this is written by Luke, "Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: 'Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' Then they gathered around him and asked him, 'Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?' He said to them, 'It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.' After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. 'Men of Galilee,' they said, 'why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven.'"
Thank you, Ken, and may God add his blessing to this, the reading and the hearing of his word and the living of it, as we too, like the disciples, have the Holy Spirit and his power at work in our lives. We continue our service now with, as we recognize our offering, we do have our offering plates on the sides of our outdoor sanctuary. We certainly do appreciate all who give to the ministry of our church family. Please, I just want to remind everybody again of the ways that we do receive gifts: by mail, or by bringing them to the office, or online giving. We are very thankful for just the generosity people have that continue to keep our ministry going. And certainly we ask and pray that we can be very responsible for what we do with our gifts to help people in our church family, in our community, and certainly in the world. So let's ask God to bless the offerings that we bring. Let us pray. Lord our God, we thank you so much for the great and giving God that you are. Thank you for the opportunities that you give us to give and to give to your work and give to your ministry. And thank you, Lord, for the work and ministry of our church family here at King Moravian. Even these past months and year now, when we haven't been able to do all that we would want to do, would like to do, and have maybe done in the past, I thank you, Lord, that we just continue to try to follow your leading and do your will. And thank you, Lord, for those who help make that possible. And certainly through the gifts of time, the gifts of talents and abilities, the gifts of a willingness to serve you. And we thank you, Lord, for the funds that are given as well, so that things can be purchased and taken care of that way. Lord, receive the gifts that we bring to you, gifts that we put in the plate, that we send in the mail, that maybe we click of a button and give online. But Lord, more importantly, receive the gifts of our lives, lives that are so thankful for your great love for us, and that we in turn want to love you and show it in the way that we live our lives and what we do with what you've given to us. Lord, certainly bless all gifts that are given and bless all givers. For these things I ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue our services. We have our anthem for our service today. Thank you, Annette, Desty, Kim, and thank you, Drake and Jennifer, for our anthem today. Beautiful music. Wow, I've kind of noticed something here up front. Looks like these handrails are painted a little bit darker than that. Not darker, but they're good and covered with paint. That looks like a sign of Jerry Saunders, I think. Jerry, have you been busy this week out here? Thank you so much for what you do. Give him a hand. That's great. Thank you, Jerry. For my message today, what I'd like to do, beginning last week and continuing today and probably in the weeks ahead, I do want to share a family series of messages. This is something I like to do this time of year, say between Mother's and Father's Day. And last Sunday, I shared a message. We looked at what the Bible says about how to take care of our parents. If you weren't here or if you haven't seen it, I hope you will. One of the things that's really nice about what we're doing today, if we have a great crowd, we know a lot of people get to hear the message and experience the service. We know people are watching it from home. And even if you miss it on a Sunday, you can catch it later. So please check out our Facebook page and our YouTube channel. Today, I want to talk about how to have an awesome family. Now, there's a lot of things the Bible tells us about how to have one, and there's a lot that I want to share with you today, but I feel I can't do it in one service. Well, I guess I could, but I really don't want you to have to sit here through a long sermon, even though it is a nice day here. You know, I almost kind of look at today. I know it's maybe a little bit cooler, but this is almost like, for me, like a Three Bears Sunday. Not too hot, not too cold, it's just right. So what a beautiful day we have to come to worship the Lord, even though it is a nice day. But what I want to do is to divide this message into two parts. The first part right now, the second part in a couple of weeks. Now today, as I talk about families, I hope that you will get something out of this message wherever you are in the spectrum of family. And I know for me and my family, this past week I was just thinking about it and seeing how my family has changed through the years. There I was in my family when I was a child, living with my dad and my mom and my brother. Later, I got married and started my own family and had a daughter and a son. Then there was a broken relationship in that family, and it was just my children and me. Then I got reacquainted with someone from my past, and Kathy and I got married and began a blended family with my two children and her two children, and which became a new family. And now that Kathy and I have grandchildren, it's like a new family again as we're in a new stage of our family life. Friends, wherever you are in your family, I believe you can be an awesome family. Now, I realize for some of our families, what you're about to hear will be a stamp of approval for what you're already doing. And my word to you is to keep on being an awesome family. For some of our families and family members, you and I need this message. And my word to us is, let's make your family and my family awesome. So how do you have an awesome family? You fight for it. Now, when I say fight, I'm not talking about with clenched fists and blazing guns. And what I'm using, and when I say the word fight, I'm using it as an intentional word. To have an awesome family is something that you have to fight for if you want it. You have to be intentional. Awesome families don't happen by accident. Average families happen by accident. You have to fight for your family if you want it to be great, because there's all kinds of forces against your family and my family in the world today. In our society, there are economic forces and spiritual forces and moral forces and cultural forces that want to destroy the idea of family and of your family and mine specifically. Now, instead of talking a lot about these negative forces, today I want to look at the more positive side and talk about how to fight for an awesome family. There's a great verse in the book of the Old Testament, the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is sent to Jerusalem to rebuild the wall surrounding the city, but the enemies don't want the wall to be rebuilt. But in Nehemiah 4:14, Nehemiah stood before the people and said, "Don't be afraid of these enemies. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome." And he said this, "Fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes." Nehemiah told the people of Israel, and I believe these words are also for you and me, to fight for your families because they're worth fighting for. And if you feel like you're in a family situation that can't change or it's too late, I want you to know that wherever you are in this spectrum of families, it's not too late to make your family better. Today, I want to begin sharing with you some traits of an awesome family. Today I'm going to look at two of these traits. In a couple of weeks, I'll share two others. And with each of these traits, I want to share a symbol for them. Each of these traits has something to do with what I'm experiencing in my life now with my grandchildren. The first symbol that I have for the first trait is this. Some of you might recognize it's a board game. You might not be able to see it from where you are, but I've become reacquainted with this game the past couple of years. The game is Candyland. You know, what's nice about this game is you don't have to be smart to play it. All you have to do is know you're... Anybody here play Candyland before? Gosh, I'm glad some of you have. If not, you've probably been a deprived child. I don't know. But it doesn't take much. All you have to do is just know your colors. And what I love doing is just sitting around with my grandson, Nolan, and granddaughter, Stella. And we have a lot of fun playing this game. And the reason that Candyland is a symbol for an awesome family is awesome families have fun. Awesome families are playful, they have fun, they enjoy life together. Now, the lack of fun can be a missing ingredient in many families today. Families can be too busy and too serious and too worn out. And who really wants to have that kind of family? Friends, the Bible says that we are supposed to work hard, but it also says we're supposed to enjoy life and to have some fun. In Ecclesiastes chapter 8, Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, said, "So I commend the enjoyment of life, because there is nothing better for a person under the sun." In 1 Timothy 6, the Apostle Paul said this, "To put our hope in God, and it's God who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment." God wants life to be enjoyed, not endured. And if you're too busy to enjoy life, friend, you are too busy. I know for me in my 26 years of marriage with Kathy, I enjoy spending time with her, whether it's going on a trip or going out to eat or getting takeout and bringing it back home or finding a show we can watch together. And even when she's got me working on one of her house projects, there's still the joy of being with her. I know as a parent, I enjoy having fun with our children, especially as they were growing up. When our children were younger, one of the fun things that we did in the summer was on Sundays when we didn't have anything going on in the afternoon. We'd load up our van, we'd drive down to Charlotte, we had season passes to Carowinds, and we'd spend the rest of the day there and have a blast. I know as a grandparent, I enjoy having fun with our grandkids. One of the fun things that Kathy and I like to do every now and then is pick up our children from preschool, Nolan and Stella, and we go get Subway or a Happy Meal, and we drive up to Pilot Mountain and have a picnic. And I love playing with the grandkids on the rocks there at the picnic area and looking for bugs. But it doesn't have to be a trip somewhere. We have a lot of fun when I just chase my grandkids around. They want to try to get away from Paw Paw. Friends, it's not so much what you do for fun and enjoyment in your family. It's just that you do it. It doesn't have to be something expensive or further down the road. It can be playing a board game or going to a park or just doing something you all like to do. One of the best things that you can do for the enjoyment in your family is give your family your time. Deep down inside, I think our family members really don't want so much the stuff that you give them. They want you and your attention and your time. And one of the best ways you show you love someone is give them some of your time to them. Take the time to enjoy your family and have some fun. Friends, your family is a gift. Now I realize that there may be some who don't see it that way, but it is. Your children, your spouse, your parents, your family members, they are a gift. And a gift is meant to be enjoyed. The other trait I want to talk about of an awesome family, I've got another symbol for you. And that is this right here. Some of you might recognize what this is, but I'm going to tell you, it's a hose attachment. In our backyard, we attach our hose to this, and this kind of helps spray water in all kinds of ways. Let's see, there's a jet spray if you need to spray something far away. I might be able to make it to David Durham over there on the porch. Or it's also got a sprinkler, a soaker setting, a shower setting. So it's just a hose extension. And for Kathy, she likes to water her plants in our backyard. What we both like to do is use this to help water the garden. To me, well, this past week, one of the fun times I've had, or a couple weeks ago, is we planted our small garden behind our house, and Nolan and Stella were there, and they helped me plant squash seeds and tomato plants. And it was special seeing them poking those seeds down into the ground and telling me where to plant the tomatoes. And it was neat hearing Nolan say the next day, "Pawpaw, I think those tomatoes are growing." You know, in many ways, a family is like a garden. You have to grow it and develop it and cultivate it. And a good garden doesn't grow on its own. You need to weed it and water it and care for it. The second characteristic of an awesome family that I want to talk about that distinguishes an awesome family from an average family is awesome families encourage growth. They create an atmosphere of lifelong growth and lifelong learning. They create a place for family members to develop talents and abilities and personalities. And it's not just growing children. Each person in your family should never stop growing. Moms should never stop growing. Dads, husbands, wives, grandparents, all should keep growing. In the Gospel of Luke, we see where how Jesus grew. There we find four kinds of growth that no matter you should be growing in, no matter what your age. Luke 2:55-52 says, "And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and with men." And the four kinds of growth we see in this church are intellectual. That's the growth in wisdom. Physical growth. That's the growth in our stature. And even if you've grown as much as you're going to grow, and maybe some of us are maybe even shrinking a little bit now, there's still the growth of maintaining a healthy body. Then another kind of growth of this verse is spiritual growth. It says in favor with God, and then there's social growth. That's the growth in favor with others. Friends, each of us should be growing in these four ways. Now, I know it's been quite a year with COVID, but let me ask you, are you different now than you were a year ago? Do you know more? Are you taking care of your body? Are you closer to God? Are you more loving toward others? Awesome families encourage growth. Average families stay the same. For our families to grow, there are things that we need to learn in our family. And there are even things that if you don't learn from your family, you're probably not going to learn them at all. And there are some things that if someone does not learn as a child, he or she is going to have a rough time in life. I want to share with you some things that you should learn in your families, although I think the word "should" is not the right word. In reality, these are things that you must learn in your family. One is what to do with feelings. This is one of the hardest and really one of the most important skills to learn. How do you handle your feelings and your emotions? In an awesome family, you learn to recognize your feelings and how to express them in a right way. In a family, you need to be honest and let people express their emotions. I know in our home, we have a grandchild that gets very emotional and all of a sudden just starts crying and bawling. But Kathy's good about letting her just go on crying and then talking it out and trying not to stuff the emotion. I've heard it said that if we tell our children to stuff their emotions, they're going to have problems with their emotions the rest of their lives. In an awesome family, you learn how to recognize a good emotion from a harmful one. A second thing we must learn in our families is how to handle conflict, how you work out problems. If our children don't see a parent or parents working problems out in a good and healthy way, how are they going to deal with the problems that they face? A third thing to learn is how to handle loss. How to grieve. Each of us will have a lot of losses in our lives, some big, some small. Nobody wins all the time. In our homes, our children need to see how to effectively deal with loss. They need to see that the loss is not an end. They need to see that if you fail or fall, you just get up and keep going. It's teaching our children how to be resilient. Without it, our children can stumble and fall and not get up. And maybe spend the rest of their lives just giving up when there is a loss. A fourth thing we must learn in our families is that what values matter most. That's what's important and what is not important. I hope that you'll agree with me that the world teaches values that are not good. The world teaches that all that matters is how you look. It teaches the more money you have and possessions you have, the more important and fulfilled you are. But friends, what matters more than, there's so much more than that. It's really what we see in advertisements and commercials all the time. But what matters more is not what's on the outside in your appearance. What really matters is the character that comes from within. What brings fulfillment in your life is not the stuff you have. It's living a life of abundance and fulfillment with the Lord and living out the plan and purpose God has for you. That's what matters most. And then a fifth thing we must learn in our families is good habits. Habits determine your character. It's teaching our children good manners. It's teaching them to respect the world that God has given and to respect others. It's teaching our children what it means to receive love and to share love. Now, besides teaching these lessons in our home, there are some other things that you can do to help your family grow. Let me give you a couple of them that work, and I also want to give you a couple things that don't work. One thing that works is through example. In our families, your family members just don't want to hear what you say. They want to see it. Jesus taught and showed a great lesson in John 13 when he washed his disciples' feet. When Jesus, their Lord and teacher, stooped down to pour water on their feet. And here Jesus is saying, just as I have done this for you, you should do this for one another. And to me, Jesus, what he did, he set a wonderful example here. Not so much for washing feet, but how to act in humility and service to others. For example, if you're in a home with two parents, dads, the greatest gift you can give your children is to love their mom. When a father shows love to another, to their mother, it creates stability and security and peace in the heart of the child. Now, there are other examples to show to your family members. The point is, set good examples and be a good witness in your home. And then a second thing that works in a growing family is through conversations. There is a time and a place for things to be talked out and shared. If you're not having conversations with your children about real issues, they're really not growing. If all you're talking about are schedules and what's for dinner and homework, not about the stuff that matters in life, they're not growing. In Deuteronomy 6, God says to impress upon your children God's teachings. And it says also when it's a good time to talk with them, when you're at home, when you're out walking, at the end of the day when you lie down, such as at bedtime, when you get up, and breakfast is a good time then. And it's not just conversations with our children. Your family grows when there are meaningful conversations with other family members. Now, there are two things that don't work in a growing family. One thing that doesn't work is not through criticizing. We think that criticizing someone will help them grow, but that doesn't work. It doesn't work because you focus on what you don't want than what you do want. Many times it's putting family members down for what they're doing instead of trying to lift them up and let them see what they should do. Criticizing reinforces the negative. If you're a parent who criticizes your child so they'll be tough, you're not making them tough. You're making them feel like a failure. And if it's constant, the time will come when they will think that they will never measure up. And if they can't measure up to you and please you, they'll just give up. They'll show you how lazy they can be or how irresponsible they can be. There's some great advice in Ephesians 6. Fathers and your parents, do not exasperate your children. In other words, do not nag them. But instead, bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. And what is this training and instruction? It's to love and encourage and build up and not tear down. And another thing that doesn't work in a growing family is through comparing. Anytime you compare someone to someone else, it is a great mistake. Why? Because everyone is unique and different, and there's nobody else like you. Comparing doesn't work. It's unhelpful, it's unhealthy, and it's unfair. You see, you can't be like someone else because you are you. In Galatians 6:4, it teaches us to test our actions and that we can take pride when we do what we're supposed to be doing. But it also says this, without comparing themselves to someone else. Friends, awesome families are fun. Awesome families encourage growth. And this is where I'll stop today. There are two other traits about an awesome family that I want you to know about. I will share these later, but for now, let me at least tell you what they are. One is an awesome family is a shelter in the storms of life. And the other is an awesome family not only serves themselves, but they also serve others. And I hope you'll be here for that message when it comes, or please join us online. Friends, awesome families aren't perfect families, but they are intentional. They become awesome by making choices and decisions and making commitments and even making sacrifices. My challenge for us is no matter what stage your family is in, that you and I will make the rest of it the best of it. I'll close with the greatest choice you can make for your family, and that is to commit your family to God. In the book of Joshua, we see where Joshua made the choice for himself and for his family. He said to the people of Israel, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. This is our greatest choice, because only then can you dads and moms and husbands and wives, only then can you become an awesome family. Let us pray. Oh Lord, our God, I thank you so much. Thank you, Lord, for those who are making that choice for you and have made that choice for their families. Lord, I thank you for those who want to be awesome, not only in their lives, but also to have a home. Lord, help us to realize that we cannot do it on our own, that we need you. Lord, it is certainly my prayer for each of us here today and those who are watching, that we can pray, as for me and for my house, we will serve you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is a hymn really of growth. It's kind of a neat hymn in our book of worship. I really wasn't that familiar with it until going through our hymnal. Lord of our growing years, I think in the five verses that we sing, you probably will find yourself in one of those. Let us stand for our closing hymn. Of our Lord and Savior and ascended Redeemer, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen.